Yeah. We got London on the track.
This is all God's doing, man. You can't plan it. But if the devil's in the details, then I'm satanic.
People's kid, how we doing? It's your boy Kobe back at it again with another video, and as always, hope you guys are having a blessed day. Today we got to talk about big news from the recruiting world, as Zion Williamson, high school phenom that has been compared by many to be the next LeBron James, has announced last week he's going to Coach K and the Duke Blue Devils. Now, while I give my school credit for getting the prized horse in Zion, I also recognize the consequences it has on the college basketball landscape. So with that said, let's get into it. Over the last decade, the Duke men's basketball program has transformed into the number one recruiting hub in the entire country. Since their iconic commitment from St. Patrick's guard Kyrie Irving in 2009, Duke has snagged up McDonald's All-American after All-American after All-American. As I already touched on in an earlier video, Kyrie changed the one-and-done culture at Duke, and it has now gotten to the point where you question if it has gotten a bit extreme. For the fourth year in a row, Duke will retain the number one recruiting class, but this class is unique for having the three ranked best freshmen in RJ Barrett, Zion Williamson, and Cam Reddish. With all these players bound to leave the following year, you have to ask, is this recent wave of next level recruiting good for Duke basketball? On one hand, it's easy to make the case that the program's brand is heightened nationally as a result of these future NBA players using the school as a stopgap. The reputation of Duke players not being able to hack it in the pros has inevitably died down because it is nearly impossible not to start seeing success when you're grabbing 2, 3, sometimes 4 lottery players every year. In addition, on the court, it is also clear the growth in athleticism and raw talent has jumped considerably since Coach K has bought into this recruiting strategy. What once was a few times a year phenomenon, the number of times you see a player do something extraordinary has become routine. But for all the amount of on-paper ability Duke has accumulated, there are definitely some costs that have come as a result. Number 1, the sheer amount of turnover year to year has raised the stakes on relying strictly on the incoming recruiting class to succeed. If one freshman class isn't up to snuff in comparison to the year before, it is more than likely the team will struggle far more considerably. A good example of this was the transition from the 2015 National Title Championship team that had a great combination of elite diaper dandies and senior leadership to the 2016 team, whose freshman production couldn't match the season before. To be fair, that isn't to say Brandon Ingram and Luke Kennard weren't great contributors, but rather it would have been nice to rely on players with more experience under their belt. Even this year, as great as Marvin Bagley and the rest of the freshman crop have been for Duke this season, their inexperience has led to considerable struggle on the defensive side of the ball. And with the need for these players to get minutes every year, the development of other four-year guys who are not as talented to play right out of the gate gets diluted, leading to wasted players who either rot on the bench or transfer. Think about former college stars that couldn't make it in the Duke rotation. Michael Benajay of Syracuse, Elliot Williams at Memphis, and most recently Semi Ojeleye at SMU, whose transfer decision paid off now as a member of the Boston Celtics. Before we continue on how Duke's recruiting is both a blessing and curse, however, let's focus on Zion Williamson. From every reputable source, there is nothing that indicated Zion would be headed to Duke. Being a South Carolina native himself, a lot of people bet on Williamson making a home state commitment to either Clemson or South Carolina. And if not one of these two, Kentucky was called upon to be a potential landing spot as well. For all of college basketball, it is kind of a stinker that one of the most hyped prep players of his generation is going to a place that really didn't need him. Instead of being the star player at every moment, he's going to share the spotlight with other freshmen that are arguably just as talented as himself. It is hard to say what his role at Duke will be next year, but you can imagine he will be placed in some type of hybrid position that will allow him to play multiple positions. Even just at 6'6", the stocky build of Williamson will be more than enough to compensate in the low post if K decides to play him there as a big from time to time. I really am curious to see how much he will be able to bully college players next year, and if he could somehow manage to outpace Marvin Bagley's dominance this year. Yet if there is one thing I know for sure about Zion and the other freshmen, I know that they will be wearing the Duke jersey for exactly one season, and their college accomplishments will be limited to that time frame. Unlike the former Duke legends of the past like JJ Redick, Grant Hill, or Jay Williams that build up moments over 3 to 4 years over their time at the school, the new stars of today make their mark immediate and then dip out afterwards. I guess that's just the way it is. Here's Zion balling out for a national title in 2019 at Duke University. Anyways guys, that's the video, hope you enjoyed. Really just thought it'd be interesting to discuss Zion and his decision to head to Duke alongside the current wave of other top recruits heading that way. Let me know your guys' thoughts on Zion's decision in the comments below. Do you think it will lead to Duke winning the title next year? And do you think it's good for college basketball as a result of him going to Duke? Love to hear your opinions. With that said, hope you guys have a great rest of the day or night. I'll be back at it soon. Peace.